I kindly request PwC to begin the training.
Thank you, Vaishak. I hope I'm audible.
Yes, you are.
Okay. So I would request Rajiv Rallan, who is the Executive Director of PwC, to please say a few words, and then we'll start with the presentation.
Thanks, Sanyukta. Good morning, everybody. So on behalf of PwC, let me thank you all because you all have been supporting our teams during this whole journey of developing these building guidelines. And I completely agree with Minister that the kind of net zero ambition which the government of Maldives has set for them, this is a critical step to maybe move forward and achieve that. So today's session, I'm very happy that we have so many professionals who are being trained. So it's kind of, so I'll request that please do interact during this training. So simulation is one of the pillars of moving towards energy efficiency in any infrastructure project. So please do ask questions, please do understand it. This is a very important milestone in Maldives' building energy efficiency journey that so many professionals have got together, and they as a team, they are learning the tools which will be used in future. So again, thank you very much. We look forward for exciting sessions, and we look forward that maybe we all interact during next few days to take this forward. Thank you. Sanyukta, please.
Thank you, Rajiv. So good morning, everyone. I'm Sayukta Pandey. I am an architect by profession, and I specialize in environmental design. I also have my team with me. So I have my colleagues, Akash Vajpayee and Pramod Rao, who are supporting the meeting today. So I hope you all enjoy and learn from the training session. So I'll just shortly begin and start sharing my screen. Yeah, Aisha, is the screen visible?
Yes,
Yes,
it's
Sayukta.
visible. Yes.
Okay, thank you. So the objective of this training is to understand the importance of building energy efficiency guidelines in Maldives. It is also to familiarize all the participants here on what is the scope of these guidelines, what is the applicability, how do we achieve compliance, and how can we really use this guideline document to aid us in designing energy efficient buildings, and also to understand the various technical aspects and provisions which are covered in the guidelines to achieve energy efficiency. And the last agenda of this training is to skillfully perform building energy performance analysis using energy modeling simulations. So we would also be conducting hands-on training on simulation softwares, and we hope that all the technical professionals, architects, and engineers here are able to learn how to do energy simulations. So just to set a bit of background on the project, we all know that Maldives' energy demand across various sectors such as buildings, tourism, fisheries is completely dependent on fossil fuels, and fossil fuels are used to generate electricity. The imports coupled with the energy subsidies which the government provides is a huge expenditure to the government's resources or the taxpayers' money. And additionally, the burning of these fossil fuels leads to the emission of greenhouse gases that causes global warming and climate change. So during daytime, the Earth's surfaces heats up as it receives heat from the sun, and at night, the Earth's surfaces cools and releases this heat back to the atmosphere. But because of these greenhouse gases, such as carbon dioxide in the Earth's atmosphere, all these things get the heat gets trapped within the atmosphere, thereby making it warmer. And we all know we are all experiencing the you know the excessive presence of GHGs in the atmosphere, which is leading to global warming effects and subsequently leading to climate change. And you know there are various adverse effects of climate change that have been observed globally. For example, melting of polar ice caps, which leads to rise in sea levels, hurricanes in certain parts of the world, droughts. So you know, so these climate change, these impacts are very adverse on the environment. They are also adverse on the nature, wildlife. They affect marine life and these erratic weather patterns. So once these impacts occur, huge costs are associated to recover from these adverse impacts. So therefore, you know, climate change is a very important goal, and it is very important to keep all of us safe from these natural disasters. And we all play a very huge role in contributing and doing our best to reduce these GHG emissions in the atmosphere. So to set this context, so Maldives being an island nation again is at a serious risk from the impact of climate change. And in 2016, 196 countries signed the Paris Agreement, where these countries decided to limit the increase in the global average temperature to 2 degrees, which was further updated to 1.5 degrees Celsius. So in line with that, the Maldives government has recently updated their NDC targets, which are to reduce the GHG emissions by 26% as compared to business as usual by 2030. And also the government of Maldives has set very ambitious targets to achieve net zero by 2030. So net zero emissions is basically means to balance the amount of emitted GHG gases with equivalent emissions that are either offset or sequestered. So keeping in line with that, Maldives government aims to develop net zero pathway, which is you know, a very, very important and ambitious thing, and it would be very good. And again, as I mentioned, it's a responsibility of all of us to contribute in the best way to help Maldives government achieve this goal. So the LCEI project was an initiative in this direction. LCEI stands for Strengthening Low Carbon Energy Islands. And this is a project which is supported from GEF, Global Environment Facility. And the Building Energy Efficiency Guidelines is a part of the LCEI project, which targets to achieve energy efficiency in design and operation of buildings in Maldives. So if we look at the current scenario of buildings in Malé or in Hulumalé or across the globe, we see that you know, the electricity consumption in buildings is increasing drastically, which is clearly seen on the rising electricity bills of our buildings. If we compare the buildings which were designed in the past and buildings which are designed today, there is a huge difference in the terms of its dependence on mechanical systems. So, in, you know, originally buildings were designed keeping the local climate in mind, and they would be naturally ventilated. But now we are pretty much dependent on air conditioning and mechanical systems to bring comfort throughout the year. And we've seen that occupants are also thermally discomfortable, which means that either we are feeling very hot or we are feeling cold. We do not have the flexibility to control our surroundings, which leads to a lot of discomfort. So this is the current scenario. We conducted various analysis of the existing buildings in Maldives, and we also conducted various surveys, and this was the common outcome of all the building occupants in Malé and Hulumalé. So the reasons behind this shift is rapid urbanization, and we've seen drastic increase in the density of these cities, the improved lifestyle of people, increased cost of real estate properties, affordability of technologies, and more importance to aesthetics. So these are a few of the reasons which is why this shift has happened. So the Maldives energy efficiency guidelines, they have been developed in order to provide minimum requirements for energy efficient design and construction of these buildings. They are applicable for new as well as existing buildings to achieve energy efficiency as well as water efficiency. And it also sets incremental requirements for building owners, architects, engineers who want to achieve enhanced level of efficiency in that buildings. So the guidelines provide minimum requirements as well as it aims for buildings to achieve higher levels of efficiency, moving towards net zero developments, which is in line with the Maldives' aim to achieve net zero by 2030. So this is the table of contents of the building energy efficiency guidelines. So I would just take you through the various sections, and the training today would be we would be giving an overview of each of the technical sections which are covered in the guidelines and what are the major requirements of the guidelines and the building physics behind this. So the first part of the guidelines talks about the purpose of the guidelines. And the applicability of the guidelines. Second chapter talks about the compliance approach and the requirements. Third is how to use the guidelines. The fourth chapter talks about climate classification of Maldives, because in order to design energy efficient buildings, the first step is to understand the local climate. So the fourth chapter talks about climate of Maldives. The fifth chapter is on bioclimatic building design strategies. It talks about the importance of bioclimatic design, what are the important components, and what are the requirements which architects, technical professionals who are designing, building designers need to keep in mind while designing new buildings. The next technical section would be on building envelope, where we would be giving an overview on the importance of designing an efficient building envelope. Why is it important? What is the building physics behind an efficient envelope, and what are the minimum requirements which are proposed in the guidelines related to various building components. The next technical section is on thermal comfort systems and controls. Again, it talks about the various thermal comfort systems, what are the minimum requirements and recommendations in the guidelines. Then we have lighting systems and control, where we cover both daylighting and artificial lighting systems and its requirements. The next section is plumbing systems, where we would be covering how to design efficient plumbing systems. The next chapter, which is chapter 10, is on renewable energy systems, and the guidelines proposes how we can offset our energy demand using renewable energy, using rooftop solar PV system or solar hot water systems. And the 11th is on building operations. So just designing energy efficient buildings is not sufficient. It's also important that the buildings is designed as well as operated in the way it has been planned. So again, this is a very important section on building operations. And the last chapter is on whole building performance method, like I mentioned. So this is where we give the flexibility to the design team to conduct simulations of their buildings and reduce their energy performance using the whole building performance method. So coming to the scope of the guidelines, so the guidelines would be applicable to four typologies of buildings, and these cover government buildings, commercial buildings, residential buildings, and hotel and guest houses. And it covers these buildings on both existing as well as new building categories, and all buildings which are in Malé and Hulu Malé will be under the applicability criteria of the guidelines. When we talk about government buildings, we cover all the buildings which are owned or operated by the government officials for delivering public services. In terms of commercial buildings, all the buildings owned or operated or occupied by private entities or individuals for providing services. Examples of these are schools, universities, stadiums, movie theater, non-communal buildings such as offices, banks, retail, malls. So all of these buildings come under the purview of the guidelines. The guidelines are also applicable to residential buildings, which cover three types: detached dwellings, basically housing, communal residential, and mixed-use residential. So mixed-use residential has been seen as one of the most common typology seen across Malé and Hulu Malé, and especially the new developments which are coming up are mainly all mixed-use. So the guidelines are applicable to all kinds of residential buildings. It also covers hotels and guest houses. So the exemptions are that the guidelines do not cover tourist resorts, which are mainly in the mainly in the islands, and there are various reference standards which are used to develop the guidelines, and they have been mentioned here, and there is proper referencing in the guidelines document wherever a particular reference standard is used. So the next is on compliance approach. So there are two compliance approach which are specified in the guidelines. The first is the prescriptive approach, wherein the design team is required to meet all the minimum mandatory requirements specified in the guidelines. So the prescriptive method, simply put, contains a menu of options which describes minimum mandatory requirements for different design and construction elements. For example, U values of building envelope, wall assemblies, window to wall ratio. So these are a few of the mandatory requirements. And then there are certain non-mandatory recommendations which are recommendations which are provided to the design team, which they can apply in their buildings. So this is the prescriptive method, which basically gives you a set of options which can be easily used, and you can make your buildings energy efficient. The second approach is the whole building performance method, wherein we follow the we calculate the EPI, energy performance index, which is nothing but the total energy consumption of the buildings per square meter per year. So we'll be talking about the second approach in the training session, which will be held tomorrow and day after. Today the training the session will mainly cover all the prescriptive requirements, and we would be highlighting which are the mandatory requirements and which are the non-mandatory requirements. And the session tomorrow will be talking on the whole building performance method. So again, if anyone has any questions up till now, please feel free to type your questions in the chat box so that we can answer them. And we will also take up a few of the questions at the end of the session. So the compliance requirements. So in terms of the new buildings, all the technical sections which are in the guidelines are applicable for new buildings during design, construction, and operation stage of the building. So all the nine technical sections that we have are applicable for new buildings. And for existing buildings, if the buildings are undergoing any major structural changes, for example, if a new floor is being added, or any other major structural change is happening in the building, then the guidelines, the respective sections are applicable for design of the existing buildings. And these mainly cover the envelope, thermal comfort system, artificial lighting, plumbing, and renewable energy system. So we now come to the first technical section, which is bioclimatic design. So bioclimatic design basically refers to design of buildings or spaces which keeps the local climate in consideration, and it aims to provide comfort to occupants by using natural resources, so sun, wind, using all the natural elements to design our buildings. And we've commonly heard this term of passive design strategies. So passive design strategies is based on bioclimatic design, which utilizes the sun, wind, vegetation, etc., to provide adequate thermal and visual comfort inside our buildings. The critical thing, the important thing for bioclimatic design is that it needs to be incorporated in the early design phase to maximize the potential of energy savings. So that's the catch, that bioclimatic design or passive design cannot be incorporated once your building designs are finalized. So the maximum potential is if we apply these principles, whatever is prescribed in the guidelines, at the very onset of the project, at a very early design stage. The various aspects which are covered include building form, orientation, shading, daylighting, ventilation, and window to wall ratio. So this chart basically talks about the climate classification of Maldives. So Köppen-Geiger is one of the most popularly used climate classification system, and it classifies the climate of the entire world into majorly five climate zones. And Maldives comes under the tropical monsoon climate. So an extensive, so we had received the climate data for the last 10 years from the meteorological services, and a detailed climate analysis was performed for Maldives. And basis that, all of these parameters were used while developing the building energy efficiency guidelines. So in terms of the brief summary of the climate of Male is that it has two seasons, dry and wet seasons. The annual temperature is around 29 degrees, which is, it's mainly above the comfort levels throughout the year. The diurnal temperature difference is around 8-10 degrees. Maldives also experiences high humidity range, which is around 75% to 80% throughout the year. And the comfort range for occupants is around 30% to 70%. So we see that it's humid almost throughout the year. The average rainfall is around 6.3 mm in dry season and around 9.5 mm in the wet seasons. And wind speed, the predominant wind direction is from west. However, due to the local design, the wind direction might vary. And the other aspect is solar radiations. So the solar radiations on various facades were calculated, and it was seen that the east and west, the radiations on east and west facade are extremely high, which is somewhere around 1200 kilowatt hour per square meter, whereas on the south facade it's 1000 kilowatt hour per square meter, and on the north it's extremely less, so around 600 kilowatt hour per square meter. Whereas the roof receives the highest solar radiation, which is almost double, 2000 kilowatt hour per square meter, giving a good potential for renewable energy harness in Maldives. So all of these parameters have been taken into account while developing the various requirements of the guidelines. So the first topic is on, so the various components of bioclimatic design, the first most important is the orientation, then comes the window to wall ratio. The third aspect that is important is shading and how we can achieve natural daylight and ventilation in our buildings. This is again a chart which I just explained in the previous slide, which talks about the solar radiation or the direct radiation which is received on various facades of the building. So like we can see in this image here that east and west receive high radiations of 1200 kilowatt hour per square meter, and the roof receives the highest radiation. So coming to the first requirement of the prescriptive requirement, this is again a recommendation in the guidelines, this is not a mandatory requirement, is based on the appropriate orientation based on the climate of Maldives. So the orientations of a building dictates the amount of heat which comes inside the building and the effectiveness of self-shading. So while developing the guidelines, we tested various orientation options, and it was observed that if we orient the building with longer facades facing south, north, or north-south orientations, then it yields the maximum benefit, which is almost 4% energy can be saved by only orienting the buildings correctly. So based on this, the guidelines suggest optimum orientations to be north-south with longer facades facing north and south. However, we do understand that sometimes there are various site constraints and it would not be possible to have all the buildings orient longer facades north-south, because sometimes it is not in the control of the designer. So in that case, an effort should be made to orient, to have maximum openings, your glass, your windows oriented towards now north and south directions. So we have these four images here, and just to make sure that I'm not making everyone sleep, I would like all of you to please type in the chat box that out of these four options, A, B, C, D, which ones do you think is correctly oriented as per the requirements of the guideline. So I'll just take a 1 minute break, and I will request all of you to just type out of these ABCD options which ones are oriented correctly as per the requirements of the guidelines. Akash, if you can please let us know if people have responded correctly.
Yes, yes. So most of the people, they are, as you said, you are not making them sleep. They are aware. So everyone has answered, and most of them has answered it correctly. Yes.
So thank you, everyone. So B and D are the correct answers. So this is basically the first step. So just by orienting our buildings correctly, that's the first step towards getting our buildings right and making them energy efficient. Obviously, if we do not have that in our control, but the design team should make maximum effort so that they can orient their buildings in this manner. And definitely, if this step is right, then the next requirements of the guidelines, so it's a compound effect. So if you're orienting it correctly, then naturally a lot of other things also fall in place. So it's always advised to, as far as possible to follow this recommendation. Then the next is to restrict the window to wall ratio. So the window to wall ratio is nothing but the window area or the glazed area of the buildings. And again, low window to wall ratio reduces the solar heat gains that comes through the windows. However, the daylight inside the space becomes poor. And if we have a higher window to wall ratio or a higher glazing area, so it might provide good daylight inside the space, but it also brings in a lot of heat inside the building, which increases the cooling requirements of the building. So there is an appropriate balance which needs to be maintained in terms of designing the window to wall ratio so that we get the optimum light levels inside the buildings, but do not let in a lot of heat come inside the building. So various simulations and analysis was performed, and basis that it is recommended again that the optimum window to wall ratio for buildings in Maldives is around 40% for all typologies. In a residential building, the window to wall ratio can be maintained at 50% for ensuring optimum daylight and natural ventilation. So this image basically tries to show that in the first case we have a window to wall ratio of 80%, and in the second case it's a window to wall ratio of 40%. So again, this is a recommendation in the guideline. This is not a mandatory requirement. However, in order to give flexibility to the designers, we have in the later chapters we have prescribed various ranges of WWR and how we can choose our glass basis the window to wall ratio of the building. But in terms of bioclimatic design, the optimum WWR to get natural daylight but limit the heat gain inside the building is 40%. So I'm sure all architects here know how to do this calculation, but we have other professionals as well. So this is a simple sample WWR calculation where we see that we have two glazings of 30 square meters each, and we have a wall opaque area of 40 square meters each. So in order to calculate the WWR, we first need to add up the glazing area, which is 30 plus 30, divided by the total wall area. So total wall area is 40 plus 30 plus 30. So the window to wall ratio of this particular wall is 60%. And so one clarification, that this is the window to wall ratio only needs to be calculated for the exposed surfaces. If we have a common wall, then WWR is the wall does not need to be included in the calculations. The next most effective strategy, passive design strategy, which works in the climate of Maldives, is shading. So in Maldives, due to the low latitude, the sun angle is very high throughout the day and almost throughout the year. So this basically means that our sun is overhead for most time of the year. So in order to reduce the direct solar radiations which enter our building, shading is a very effective strategy. And the guidelines proposes overhangs on all orientations to provide solar protection throughout the year. And so the basic requirement at the guidelines is includes 600 mm overhangs on all facades. In case where 600 mm overhangs is not possible, it is recommended to go in for recessed windows, which is shown in figure D. And shading requirements are applicable to the floors that do not receive any shading from adjacent building. So if there are adjacent buildings which are taller and which are casting a shadow on your particular building, then shading requirements need not be followed. But if there is no overshadowing from the adjacent buildings, it is recommended to provide 600 mm overhangs on all building facade. And again, shading is a very effective strategy which can help reduce energy saved by up to from 8 to 12% in a building. So these are very simple strategies which do not, which just needs to be kept in mind while designing. They do not incur any additional cost. So these are a few examples for how the designers can design their shadings. So for north and south orientation, horizontal shades are a very effective way to cut the sun. And if there are east and west orientations, then vertical shades or both horizontal and vertical shades can be used to cut the direct sun in the buildings. Then the next requirement for bioclimatic design is to achieve natural daylight. So as you all know, natural daylight is a very important feature of any good building, and it leads to a lot of health benefits. It increases the productivity of occupants, reduces absenteeism. So there are a lot of benefits which are associated with natural daylight. But however, we see in the contemporary buildings or, you know, the building designs, there are very few buildings which are naturally daylit. So the objective of the guidelines is to ensure that we have buildings which are naturally daylit, and around 10% of the total building energy can be reduced by incorporating natural daylight in the buildings. So as a rule of thumb, the daylight penetration is twice the window head height. So when we are designing, when we are finalizing the floor depth, the floor plate, or the depth of our buildings, it is recommended to provide it twice as deep as the window height. So in this particular image on the left, we see that we have the window height. The top of the window is at 3.6 meters. So we can easily say that up to 7.2 meters, we would have we would have daylight penetrating inside the buildings. However, if we have a floor plate which is much deeper, then naturally the center part of the building which will not receive natural daylight. And the second chart here talks about the various building footprint that optimize daylight. So like we mentioned, these are various few examples of building forms that can be adopted to maximize the north and south orientations. So north orientations provide diffused daylight, which are extremely good for, you know, for work areas. It does not provide any glare. So the effort should be made to orient, the longer facades, the windows towards north, and to get diffused daylight throughout the year. So these are a few examples of the optimized building footprint. Then spaces where natural daylight cannot be achieved, there are various technologies. So we have the tubular daylight devices, which can help get daylight. So this image below gives an example of that. So for example, if there are basements or there are areas where daylight cannot be achieved, these technologies can be used to achieve daylight. We also have light shelves, which can be added in the building. Light shelves basically help to achieve daylight towards the depth of the floor plate. So they help in reflection of light, and it helps in farther reach of daylight inside the space. And various daylight responsive lighting controls can also be used in the building, which is basically based on having daylight sensors which can balance, which can detect if there is appropriate lux levels inside the building. So it automatically switches off your artificial lighting and reduces your lighting load inside the building. So these are few recommendations and the guidelines which can be adopted by the design team or by the building owners. The guidelines, so or sometimes it's also observed that, you know, buildings are designed in order to get natural daylight, but because of the interior planning and the design of floor plate, the daylight gets lost in the building. So we've seen a lot of buildings where there are a lot of windows, but the interior layout is done in a manner that, you know, occupants are not receiving any daylight. So these are the image on the left and the image on the right is an example of that. So on the image on the right, we see that buildings, the interior floor plan has very high partitions and they are opaque partitions. So, you know, the natural light is not received. Whereas the image on the left, we see that, you know, there is a low height partition and again, there are non-opaque partitions. So these are a few examples of how we can optimize interior design, daylight optimized interior design in our buildings. So the guideline recommends that at least 70% of the spaces should be naturally daylit, and it also provides the illuminance or the lux levels which should be achieved in various spaces of the building as per the EN standards. So again, I would like, there are these three images which are shown here. The first on the top, the second image on the left and the third image on the bottom. So I would like all of you to select that which is which of these two images is not correct and which is the correct image in terms of receiving appropriate daylight inside the buildings. So I would request all of you to write which of the two of these images is not correct and which is the correct image. So we can take a 1 minute break. So Akash, if you can please let us know if people have answered on the chat box.
Yes, they have answered, Sanyukta, and well within the requirements. Yes.
Okay. So the first two images on the top are not the ideal practices for daylighting, whereas the third image is ideal. In the first image, we see that there is a lot of glare which is seen because of the large amount of glass which is used in the building. So that's why it's not correct. In the second image, we see that although there are windows, but the blinds are down and the light lux levels which are received are not appropriate and there is not enough natural light, which is why artificial lighting is turned on, which is again not a good practice. And this is mainly this happens when not enough thought has gone in designing the right amount of glass inside the building. So it completely defeats the purpose and people put down their blinds throughout the day and keep their artificial lights on. So it gives a huge penalty on the cooling load as well as on the lighting load of the building. And in the third case, we see that windows are designed keeping in mind low window to wall ratio. And there is also a skylight which is designed which provides good daylight inside. So this was just a few examples on how we can design our interior design of buildings to achieve natural daylight. Next important topic is ventilation, and looking at the climate of Maldives, ventilation is a very important requirement, and endeavors should be made to maximize the natural ventilation inside the building. And ventilation is a prerequisite to maintain good indoor air quality and avoid any health hazards, and to enable fresh air circulation inside the building. So the guideline provides various standards for minimum performance of ceiling fans, and it also specifies the air change rate per hour which needs to be achieved in spaces in order to ensure adequate ventilation. So there are various options to maximize natural ventilation in the building. We have single-sided ventilation, we can have cross ventilation, and again stack ventilation. So the guideline provides various recommendations on how we can appropriately place our window openings to achieve these strategies. And again, we can also go in for mixed mode ventilation, which is a combination of natural ventilation and mechanical ventilation, which is basically based that when the climate outside is conducive, we operate the building in natural ventilation mode, where we use operable windows and we do not use mechanical systems. The windows can be designed in a way where there is appropriate wind. So we so guidelines provides the wind directions, and we can orient our windows in that direction. It can lead to natural ventilation. And when the outdoor temperature, so there's a temperature sensor which detects the outdoor temperature, and when that is above the comfort range, then automatically the buildings go in mechanical ventilation mode, and the HVAC system is turned on. So again, the guideline provides recommendations on how we can design buildings which are mixed mode. These are again a few strategies, ventilation design techniques of where to orient the window openings so that we have a wind movement in the living zone of where the occupants are. So the positioning of the windows is again very critical, and this image shows various good and bad examples of our window openings in order to maximize the wind movement. So since the climate of Maldives is humid, so ventilation is a very important strategy in achieving comfort, and we do not need to have air conditioning on 24/7. If the buildings are designed so that there is enough cross ventilation, it can lead to comfort, and we can avoid the use of ACs throughout the year. So as far as possible, an effort should be made to have window openings and enhance natural ventilation in the building. So that completes our first section on building envelope, and we'll now come to the second most important section, which is that completes bioclimatic design. So now we'll move to the building envelope section. So the building envelope refers to the exterior facade of the building. It comprises of both the opaque components and the fenestration systems, and it includes walls, roofs, slabs, basement walls, and opaque doors and windows. And fenestration systems includes windows, skylights, ventilators, and doors that are more than 1.5 size based. So building envelope components should be selected that the energy consumption is minimized and we achieve visual and thermal comfort inside the buildings. There are two aspects which are covered in the guidelines. First is the wall and roof assembly, and the second important aspect is the design of the window glazing. So before we jump to that, a bit of building physics. So we've all read in school that how heat transfers. So there are three ways where how heat transfers. So there is conduction, convection, and radiation. So conduction is mainly when energy is transferred from a hot side to a cold side. And a typical example of this is when we touch a stove and we burn our hands. So this is an example of conduction. Convection is when heat is transferred using movement of molecules. And the image shows like a typical example is a radiator, which creates a convection cell in a room by emitting warm air at the top and drawing in cool air at the bottom. And the third, how heat travels, is radiation. And radiation is basically when heat comes from a source and it travels through space and it does not need any medium. So for examples of this are heat from a fire, or heat coming from sun, or heat coming from light bulbs. So these are the three ways. So similarly, the heat transfer mode in a building happens through these various components. So we have, the conduction happens from roof, from walls, from the silt floor, and from the windows. Convection typically takes place from the ventilation openings or the infiltration openings inside the building. And radiation happens from the windows, which is mainly solar radiations that we talked about earlier as well, the direct solar radiations, which come inside the building through the window openings. So basically, these are the important parameters, the wall, roof, infiltration, and the glazing, which basically impact the amount of heat which is coming inside our buildings. So therefore, the building envelope design is a key parameter for energy efficient building design. So the guideline prescribes various requirements to design our envelopes correctly. So basically, every material that we use in our building has a conductivity. And conductivity is nothing but it's an ability of a material to transmit heat or electricity. So if a building has a higher conductivity, it can transfer heat, it can transfer more heat. And so if we have to calculate, so when we divide the thickness of that material with the conductivity value, we get the resistance of the building. And 1 divided by the resistance gives us the U value. So the guidelines basically prescribes the U values, which are thermal transmittance of various building materials. And the important aspect to remember here is that the lower the U value, the better it is. So by limiting the U value of the building envelope components, heat ingress can be controlled in the buildings. So in the guidelines, we have provided the conductivity, which is the key value of the commonly used building materials in Maldives. And also when we are choosing the building materials of our building, the manufacturer can provide the material specifications, which includes the conductivity. So once we have the conductivity, and once we know the thickness of the material, it is very easy to calculate the U value of our various building envelope. So we'll have one example here, which can basically help. So this is a typical example of an external wall of a building where we have these 4 layers. We have cement mortar, so we have solid brick, and we have cement mortar, and we have insulation. So these are the 4 building envelope materials that are being used. We have the thickness of each of these materials. So solid brick is 200 mm, the cement mortar are 15 mm on each side, and then we have insulation. We also have the conductivity of each of these materials. So in order to get the resistance, we divide the thickness divided by the conductivity of each of these layers. So this comes to 0.306, and 1 divided by the total resistance gives us the U value of this particular wall, which comes out to be 3.26 watt per meter square Kelvin. So this is a very simple calculation. We just need to know the conductivity and thickness of the various envelope of our total assembly of our wall or our roofs. So in terms of the guidelines, so the energy consumption of the buildings can be reduced through proper selection of the wall material and improving the U value. So the lower the U value, the better it is, and it will lead to less amount of heat, conductive heat gains inside the building. And there are various materials which are available in the market that can be used. There are new materials also which have come up, which offer very good, very low U values. So the guideline prescribes that the maximum U value of the wall assembly should be 1.2 watt per meter square Kelvin, and for optimum reduction in heat gains. And if you want to achieve higher energy efficiency, so 1.2 can be further reduced to about 0.9 watt per meter square Kelvin. So this is the value which is prescribed in the guidelines. It does not give any limitation to designer to use, does not prescribe any material as such that one needs to use this material or that material, but the overall U value of the assembly should be 1.2 watt per meter square Kelvin. So these are a few examples. So if we have a 150 mm RCC wall with no plaster, we see that the U value for this wall assembly is about 3.77 watt per meter square Kelvin. If we use concrete blocks, 200 mm with 15 mm plaster on both sides, the U value gets further reduced to 2.8 watt per meter square Kelvin. If we use a 230 mm brick with 15 mm plaster on both sides, we can further reduce the U value to 1.7 to 2.24 watt per meter square Kelvin. These are few new materials which can be used. It's called autoclaved aerated concrete, a very lightweight material, which if we only use 200 mm of AAC with 15 mm plaster, we can get a U value of 0.77 watt per meter square Kelvin. And if we use a 300 mm AAC block with 15 mm plaster, it gives a U value of 0.54 watt per meter square Kelvin. So these are a few examples of achieving the optimum U value for our wall assemblies. Then we come to the roof. So like we saw earlier, maximum solar radiations are received on the roof, and especially if we have a building which is low height, 1 to 2 floors, then it's very important to limit the heat gains which are coming from the roof. And again, the guidelines prescribes the maximum U value for roof assembly, which is 0.9 watt per meter square Kelvin. And in order to achieve higher efficiency, the designers can, you know, further reduce the U value of their roof assembly to 0.6 watt per meter square Kelvin. And there are various materials which are available on the market. By simply applying 50 mm or 100 mm of these insulation materials, we can reduce our U values of our roof. So these are few examples of materials, like for example, glass wool. If used 100 mm thickness, it can achieve a U value of 0.32 to 0.44. Then we have rock wool insulation, extruded polystyrene insulation, polyurethane foam-based insulation. So there are various insulation available in the market, and we can get the specifications from the manufacturers and use these materials to achieve the overall U value of the roof assembly. Then again, there is a concept of cool roof. So in hot climates, a very effective way to achieve energy efficiency is through cool roofs. And this can also help in reducing the energy, HVAC energy costs. It basically the concept is to provide high emissivity surfaces at the roof that basically emit the solar radiation. So it does not absorb the radiations, it emits the radiation. And there are very simple techniques which can be used as a cool roof. So we can paint our surfaces white, we can use a metal roof, we can use broken China mosaic tiles on our roof. We can also use, we can use landscaping on our roof, and also we can use, various shading devices which can be used to basically have the roof shaded. So these are a few examples which can again, drastically help in reducing the heat gains which are coming from the roof. Then coming to the glass, so the selection of glass is again a very important parameter, and in terms of energy efficiency, and the important criteria to keep in mind while selecting the glass is the solar heat gain coefficient. So the solar heat gain coefficient is nothing but the amount of incident radiation which comes inside from the windows. And the SHGC varies from 0 to 1, And again, the lower the SSGC, the less is the amount of solar radiations which comes inside the building. So the guidelines prescribe various SSGC values. And again, whenever we are selecting glass, whichever manufacturer we are going in for, Saint-Gobain or Asahi or the commonly used glasses, we should definitely ask the manufacturer for the SSGC value. And this is a value which is easily, which can be, easily received from the manufacturer. So the guideline prescribes that it doesn't fix one SSGC value. It gives a flexibility to designers that places on the amount of glass area you have, we need to select the appropriate SSGC value for the glazing. So obviously, if the building has the right amount of glass, like we mentioned, 30 to 40%, then we don't need to go in for a very, very low SSGC glass, and the SSGC can be in the range of 0.6 to 0.5. However, if the architects and the design team wishes to have a large amount of glass in their building and wants to have a large window to wall ratio of 60 to 70% or more, then in order to make sure that we do not penalize energy consumption of the building, and we do not lead to a lot of rise in our electricity bills because of so much amount of glass in the building. So therefore, the guidelines prescribes a very low SSGC, which is 0.25 SSGC glass, so that we can balance the high glazing area. So this these SSGC values of 0.25, 0.3, 0.4 can be achieved in both single glazing as well as in double glazed units. Another very effective strategy to achieve these SSGC level is to go in for shading. So the moment we have shading, we can reduce, reflect the solar radiations which are coming from the window area. So the guidelines now gives flexibility to the designers to select the glass based on the various WWR ranges. So yeah, that's about it from the building envelope section. And if anyone has any questions, Akash, I would like you to take up the questions that have come in the chat box, or if there is any section where I went too fast, so I would be happy to go through that section again. So thank you.
So meanwhile, when the participants they can type the questions, but we have received one questions before your presentation. So it's more related to why has the tourism sector been exempted from the guidelines. I think this was brought up during initial discussions as well. Is there are specific policy decisions from ministry about the tourism sector? So I think Inaz, if you can take up, or Sayukta, if you want to take up.
Maybe I'll request Inaz and Rafa to take up this question. Inaz?
Okay, so once he's here, we'll take up these questions. Any other questions? Anyone wants to ask any other question, he can type in the chat box and we can answer that. So one question, slide number 44, regarding roof assembly, how is metal roof a cool roof? Can you please elaborate?
So metal roof also helps to not absorb the solar radiation. It helps in reflecting the solar radiation. So that's why it comes under an example of a cool roof.
Okay, so if there is any other question, we can take up. I think.
Hello.
Yes.
You can hear me now. Yes, sorry, I had a mic issue earlier just now.
Okay.
No, please repeat the question again.
Yeah, sure, I can repeat. Just a second. Yes. So the question is, why has the tourism sector been exempted from the guidelines? I think this was brought up during initial discussions as well. Is there are a specific policy decision from the ministry about the tourism sector? Will there be a different set of more stringent requirements for tourism sector, or will there be no requirement at all? Makes no sense to give a blanket exemption to tourism sector. This has been asked by Mr. Abdullah Hussain Rashid.
Yes, we have discussed this several times over the development of the guidelines. We would like to say that this is what we the work we have been able to do now. We have developed this guideline as a national guideline by of existing buildings in the Male and Hulu Male area. So that's how we have made the applicability to local islands and Male and Hulu Male, etc. And that's why tourist resorts are an exemption, because we still need to do the surveys or get the initial baseline information for developing a guideline for the resorts. But would like to highlight that from the tourist sector, the guest houses will be able to, this guideline is applicable to the guest houses. So and the ministry is ministry has the thinking to work towards developing a guideline for the resorts as well. Just that we are at the beginning steps, and this is what we have for now.
Okay, thanks, Papa. Senator, next question is for you. Will the guideline is going to be a good practice one, or will it be a mandatory one?
I think I can answer that as well, because this is the first time we are putting the guideline in place. So we are going to let it be a voluntary guideline for now, and we will be working with Ministry of National Planning to make it mandatory step by step. But initially, when we start, it is going to be a voluntary guideline.
Yes, Sanyukta. Will the recommended wall assembly U value not be met by using local brick 150 mm and 200 mm bricks?
Yes. So to answer that question, it depends on, again, the conductivity of the brick that is being used. So we assessed a few materials which are commonly used. So if you have a masonry block, which is typically around 200 mm thick, and if we use a plaster of 15 mm, then we are able to achieve the U value which are prescribed in the guidelines. So even the RC material, which is commonly used along with plaster, on 200 mm of RC material, which has a conductivity of 1.6, we are able to achieve the U value prescribed in the guidelines. So it basically depends on the conductivity of that material, and the values which are prescribed in the guidelines should be achievable by the brick, 200 mm brick.
Okay, and the next one is related to the wall paint color. So the question is, does the wall paint color play an important role in building efficiency? Is this included in the guidelines, or is it not significant enough?
So yes, so the wall paint color is not, it does play a role. So if we have our walls painted white, it helps in maximum reflection of daylight. So, you know, it is always recommended to, you know, to, in order to maximize the daylight within a space, to have the walls painted white. However, this is not something, it is not a very, it does not lead to very significant energy savings. So it's not something which is prescribed in the guideline, but yes, as a good practice, the wall paint color, especially light colors, help in reflecting a lot of natural daylight. So this is again a recommendation. It's a recommendation, but it's not something which is included in the guidelines.
Okay, and the next one, I think Rafa, you can answer. It's on the exemption which you have just explained. So the question or the suggestion is that it cannot be called as a national guidelines if the resorts are exempted.
Yes. Well, when we are giving the title, we will consider it accordingly.
Right, right. And next one is on the implementation side. So if the guidelines are not mandatory, will there be any government incentive given initially to promote adherence to the guidelines?
From the LCAI project, we are trying to put in place some incentivized mechanism, but it's in the works at the moment, so I can't give any details right now. So when if we're able to set something up, we will definitely be giving out this information and promoting it accordingly. But right now, the status is that we are working on it.
Right. Next one again. So the question is something related to the implementation, and again we are working on it. So the question is, how is this guideline going to fit into regulatory framework of the construction industry in relation to the existing Construction Act and many other regulations currently active? So Sanyukta, can you briefly talk about this?
So the Ministry of Environment is currently working with the MNHPI, and this is a work in progress, and we are trying to integrate the guidelines in the regulatory framework of the buildings. And so it's currently a work in progress, and maybe Rafa, if you would like to elaborate on this point. I think they're facing some connection issues. So basically, the guidelines will be integrated, in the building approval system. So if we are going in for, design permit to get, design permit for our buildings, so it would be integrated in a manner where all the new buildings which are coming up will have to show compliance of the minimum requirements as per the guidelines. And for the existing buildings, like I mentioned, if we are adding if we are making any major structural changes in our building, we are adding a new floor, then the guidelines will be applicable. For the existing buildings which are there in Malé, currently we have not developed any regulations. So that is something which is yet to be finalized. And once it's done, we will definitely let you know.
All right. So I think we can proceed to the next section, Sanyukta.
Yes, Akash.
So I'll just project my screen to take up the next section. My screen is visible, Sanyukta?
Yes.
Okay. So this particular section is about the thermal comfort systems and the controls to optimize the operation of these thermal comfort systems. So basically, why do we need these thermal comfort systems? So because of the climatic conditions and to remove the heat from the space and to achieve the thermal comfort condition, which are related to relative humidity, temperature, air velocity. So to meet all those comfort conditions, we have these systems in place, which we are using nowadays very vastly. So all kind of thermal comfort systems are covered into these guidelines. And in a nutshell, we call them as a HVAC system. So heating, ventilation, and air conditioning equipments. So which are HVAC systems. So heating is more or less not applicable in this climatic zone, but the ventilation and air conditioning systems, they are covered into the guideline. And the guideline gives you all the requirements related to centralized or non-centralized air conditioning systems which we are using into the buildings. So frequently means what visits we have done, we have conducted into the existing buildings in Male and Hulumale. So we witnessed that most of the buildings are using non-centralized unitary air conditioning systems, and some of the buildings which are recently constructed and they are modern in the nature, they are using the central air conditioning systems there into the buildings. So both kind of systems are covered into the guidelines. And how do we achieve energy efficiency with the systems, we will see into this particular section. So this is a basic how a air conditioning system typically work. So there are four components into a air conditioning systems, which are compressor, condenser, and condenser can be air cooled or water cooled. Then we have evaporator and the expansion valve. So whatever unit you are seeing into your indoor side, so that is basically a evaporator, and the machine which you place at the outdoors, which rejects the heat into the atmosphere, that is the condenser part which is there into the outside of the building. So all those components jointly covers the air conditioning process cycle, and we will not go into the technical side of it, where the refrigerant comes, when it is a high pressure, where it is a low pressure. So this is just for illustration purpose that this is how a system looks like technically when there is an air conditioning system in place. So there are two kind of systems, non-centralized and the centralized one. So as you can see into the images, the non-centralized air conditioning systems, the typical examples are split AC, which are there commonly used into the buildings, there into the Maldives, window ACs, and the cassette ACs, which are also used. So how to identify whether a system is non-centralized or it is a centralized? So just to give you a typical example, if your indoor unit is connected, one indoor unit is connected with one outdoor unit. So that is an example, typical example of non-centralized air conditioning system. So in these three kind of systems, split AC and the cassette AC, you have one indoor AC which is placed into your regularly occupied space, whether it be your office or reception or classroom or your hotel room or any other area. And then you have one outdoor unit placed, which is connected in particular this indoor unit. So this is a typical example of non-centralized air conditioning system. Whereas in the centralized air conditioning system, we have one outdoor unit, which is most commonly seen in the case of VRV or the VRF. So VRV is the latest technology which is coming up there. And the full form is variable refrigerant flow or volume. So with this system, you find that there is a one big outdoor placed on the roof or outside of the building, and it is connected with the multiple indoor units in the office area or the hotel area or any other area which is the building is having. So these indoor units can be varied by size and the design. So one VRF unit can have different type of indoor units. It can be a cassette AC, it can be a split AC, it can be a fan coil unit even. So it can be concealed into the false ceiling, and you can get your airflow from the concealed fan coil unit. So it can have multiple types of indoor unit, but all those indoor units would be connected to a single outdoor unit which is placed on the roof or outside of the building, which rejects heat into the atmosphere. Chillers, so there are two types of chillers, and all those chillers and means all these technologies are refrigerant based. So they have the refrigerants with them, and which gives you a cooling effect. So the chillers could be two types, water cooled or air cooled. And when we place chillers into the building, so most commonly it is seen when there is a huge building, large size of air conditioning is required, So then the applicability or the feasibility of placing chillers for thermal comfort applications rises. And in case of chillers, we have typically a plant room where you have chillers, primary and secondary pumps. Then you have a cooling tower, which is either placed on the ground or on the roof. Then you have AHUs, which are air handling units. They are placed floor to floor. And then you have ducting, which serves your air, which is the cool air which is generated from AHU. Then it carries the duct carries that cool air to the spaces, and then you see the diffusers and the air terminal units, which gives you the cool air in your spaces. And then there is a return system of either from the plenum or from the duct, which is hidden most commonly, which is hidden into the false ceiling and into the corridors, which is not visible to the common man. But this is how a typically system is placed into the buildings. These are some energy efficiency parameters, and this is again, so all those parameters defines, they are the indicators of how efficient your systems are. So first one is coefficient of performance. In short, we call it as COP. So this indicates the efficiency of cooling or heating machines, and it is the ratio of cooling capacity divided by electrical power. So whatever cooling capacity your system is having, and it is divided by the electrical power which is required to run your compressor, basically. So if your compressor is using power and then it gives you some cooling capacity, so the ratio is called as COP. Then the other one is energy efficiency ratio. So this is the ratio of cooling capacity in BTU to the power unit in the watts. The third one is cooling seasonal performance factor, CSPF. So this is the ratio of total annual amount of heat that is that can equipment can remove from the indoor air when operated for cooling in active mode to the annual amount of energy consumed by equipment during the same period. So this is the annual consumption. This indicates the annual performance of a device or of equipment, and whatever amount of heat it is rejecting annually, and whatever amount of power it is consuming annually, the ratio is called from called as CSPF. So in the guidelines we have indicated this as an indicator and the CSPF, because in the recently standard and labeling program which is there in for the air conditioning system, so this is the indicator which they have used. So we have kept it uniform, and this is the indicator which indicates the efficiency of the unitary or non-central air conditioning systems in the buildings. The third one is IPLV. So IPLV is integrated part load value, and this is the measure of weighted average efficiency of COP of air conditioning on various load conditions. So if you are having a chiller and it is having a the capacity of 100 tons, so the efficiency which we are getting if it is loaded 25%, if the efficiency which we are getting if it is loaded 50%, if it is loaded 75%, and if it loaded at 100% at different temperatures, so the weighted average is called as IPLV. So it is understood that the system, the central air conditioning system, they work most efficiently on part load conditions. They do not give their maximum efficiency on the full load conditions. So to achieve those part load conditions and to give this flexibility to the designers that on what part load conditions they gives the maximum efficiency, this IPLV is the indicator, and this helps the designers, and they use this indicator in selecting of the equipments and designing the air conditioning systems for the buildings. So higher the value of these parameters gives the indicates that the systems are more efficient in the nature. So these are the mandatory things which are included into the guidelines. So this is for non-centralized unitary air conditions. So as we see, the all the split units and the cassette units which are there in the existing buildings also, which we see most commonly. So this is for these kind of equipments. So for the ACs, for all split windows having cooling capacity less than 4.5 kilowatt, which is 1.3 TR, TR is ton, so 1.3 tons, and in between 4.5 to 7.1, which is within the range 1.3 ton to 2 tons, the minimum CSPF should be at least level 1. So energy efficiency level 1, which is there into the standard and labeling program. So what we have recommended, that all the ACs which are having capacity less than 4.5, it means that all the ACs which are having capacities less than 1.3 tons, they should have the energy efficiency level within this range of 3.3 to 4.6. So this needs to be achieved. This is a mandatory thing for the selection of the equipment with this energy efficiency requirement. And for all ACs which are there into the range of 4.5 to 7.1, so they should have this 3.1 to 4 energy efficiency level. So this is mandatory for the under the guidelines. The next level is the recommendation. So if you achieve the mandatory thing and if you want to go further with the efficiency of the equipment, so then you can go to the energy efficiency level 1 and to level 3. So for all the equipments which are having the cooling capacity less than 4.5 kilowatt, which is 1.3 ton, so they should have they can meet the energy efficiency level 2, so which is 4.6 to 5.3, and energy efficiency level 3, which is greater than 5.3. so once you meet the mandatory, if you want to go further, then we have the option how do you select, what is the next level you can achieve. So then you can go for the energy efficiency level 1 or energy efficiency level 3 for different range of the equipments for non-centralized unitary air conditioning systems. This is for VRF. So this is the technology picking up this region, and this is efficient in a nature. So VRF, the full form is variable refrigerant flow or variable refrigerant volume. So if you are having this size category of 40 kilowatt, so 40 kilowatt refers to 11.3 ton. So if your system size is less than 11.3 ton, then you should have energy efficiency ratio as 3.28. And if your system size is between 40 to 70, which gives you the range of 13.7 ton to 19.9 TRs. So if your system is having within this range, then your EER should be in this range of 3.26. And if your system is greater than 70, means greater than 19.9 or 20 tons, so then you should have your energy efficiency ratio as 3.02. So this is mandatory under the guidelines when you are going with the VRF system. So all the mandatory requirements which you are seeing for non-central or central things, the equipments are available in the market. They are very well into the use. They are technically and financially feasible. So there is nothing which cannot be achieved. They are most commonly used nowadays into the market, and people are adopting these things. And this is very initial phase of the equipment selection. So you can get these efficiencies very easily into the market when you are opting for these equipments. This is for air cool chillers. So if your system size is 260 kilowatt, less than 260 kilowatt, so which offers you the range of 74 tons. So if your air cool chiller is less than 74 tons, then your EER should be 2.8 energy efficiency ratio, and your IPLV, integrated part load value, which is on the different loading conditions of 25%, 50%, 75% and 100%, and this is the weighted average of all those values which you achieve on different part load conditions. So all the manufacturers, they give these values in their catalogs, in their product catalogs, under the technical specifications, and this can easily be asked, and they are very well aware about the energy efficiency requirements under different rating systems or the guidelines of different countries. So they have kept it uniform, and this terminology is also uniform. You can find it throughout the globe, that this is the uniform thing of the indicator of energy efficiency while we are talking about air cooled chillers or the water cooled chillers. And if your system size is equal to or greater than 260 kilowatt, which is around 74 tons, then you should have your EERs as 3 and IPLV as 3.7. So this is mandatory under the guidelines if you are selecting air cooled chillers for your building. This is recommended under the guidelines for the air cooled chillers. So if your system size is 260 kilowatt, which is 74 ton, so you can achieve energy efficiency level 2 or 3, and these are the EER and COP requirements for going further into the energy efficiency while selecting air cooled chillers. This is for water cooled chillers. So it gives you various range of the water cooled chillers. So it starts from 260 ton and it 260 kilowatt, which is 74 ton, and it goes up to 1580 kilowatt. And this is the mandatory thing. So if you are going for air cooled chiller for your building, and if you are having tonnage within this range, so for an example, if you are having tonnage less than 260 tons, and if you are going for water cooled chiller for thermal comfort application, then the energy efficiency ratio should be 4.7 and the COP should be 5.8 for selecting the chiller. This is the mandatory requirement to meet energy efficiency level 1. So it offers the water cooled chillers. They comes in different brackets of the cooling capacity. When we talk in terms of cooling capacity, so they comes in different brackets, and so this is how this size category is identified based on the market availability of the equipments. Again, so this is for energy efficiency level 2 and efficiency level 3. So this is recommended. Once you meet this mandatory thing, and if you want to go further, if you see there is a potential of saving in the huge building when you are operating 24 hours. For an example, if you are having a hospital and which operates 24 hours throughout the year, so then you have more potential of saving your energy. So if you are not satisfied that, okay, I have met mandatory thing, and if I can also put my efforts to go further and achieve efficiency with my systems, so then you can also opt for efficiency level 2 or 3. And these are recommended into the guidelines. These are not mandatory. So this is recommended under the guidelines. When we talk about the controls, so several types of controls should be there for the optimized operations of the efficient systems which you have already installed in your buildings. So for an example, you have you opted for energy efficiency level 2 for your chiller, and which gives you very good energy efficiency ratio and COPs, but it's not operated well, so the efficiency is also not achieved. So that's why the systems along with the controls is necessary. So in order to achieve, in order to get that performance which you have desired or which you have estimated at the time of design. So first one is the time clock control. So time clock control basically automatic start or the stop in the layman language. So based on the different schedules, the chillers should be on or off based on the occupancy, based on the different schedules. So we have three component in it. First one is the system can start or stop the system under different schedules for three different days types per week. So this is more or less applicable for the 24 hour running buildings or a BPO kind of buildings or a hospital kind of buildings which are having different operating schedules, different occupancy levels. So with that, you can optimize your chillers also, and you can choose which chiller to on what time, which chiller to shut down at what time. So you can control these kind of things with this time clock control. Second one is are capable of retaining programming and time setting during loss of power for a period at least 10 hours. So in case of there is a loss of power, so the programming should be able to withstand that that existing programming for 10 hours, and it should not be resetted if the power is not available. Include an accessible manual override that allows temporary operation of the system for up to 2 hours. So in case of system failure, these all are sensor based things. So in case of system failure, there should be a manual override, and one can control them manually as well. So these kind of provisions should be there. So buildings like office, schools, college, hospital, malls have air conditioning system size greater than 100 TR, excluding unitary ACs of all size. So 100 TR typically for central air conditioning systems, if you are having or the condition area greater than 2000 square meters should have time clock control. So this is recommended, this is not mandatory. So all the buildings which are having system size 100 tons or the condition area more than 20,000 square meters should have these kind of time clock control for their air conditioning systems. Second one is temperature control. So all mechanical cooling equipment should have temperature control mechanism, and most of them which we see into the buildings are operated, or we can regulate those temperatures by setting the thermostat. So for the unitary air conditioning systems, we have the remote in our hands and we can easily set the temperature of whatever we like, starts from 18 to 26, 27, 28, so we can set those temperatures. So what the guidelines recommends you, so for hotels, thermostat control for each guest room in hotel, each conference room and banquet hall. So all the guest room, all the conference room and the banquet hall, they should have the thermostat controls. For educational buildings, thermostat control for each classroom, staff room, lecture room, computer room should be there. For office, the thermostat control should be there for each cabin, conference room, meeting room and common office floor areas. For malls, shopping complex, the control should be for each shop, and public area to be controlled centrally by a operator of the building of that particular shopping mall or the complex. For hospital, the thermostat control for in and out patient rooms. And this control is recommended for all types of air conditioning system, whether it be unitary or central air conditioning systems in any type of buildings which are mentioned there, which includes hotels, education, office, malls and hospitals. Then we have occupancy controls. So occupancy control should be installed to de-energize or to throttle to minimum the ventilation or the air conditioning system when there are no occupants. So generally what we have seen, there is no occupancy and the systems are running, and this happens mostly into the unitary air conditioning system, and which we can see easily into our day-to-day life. So what we have recommended into the guidelines, that each guest room in the hotel should have this occupancy control. When there is a no occupancy, the system should throttle to minimum ventilation or air conditioning, whatever the size is. So just to give you an example, in the unitary air conditioning systems, we have inverter AC concept there. And what happens into this inverter AC concept, the compressor having the ranges of its operation. So it can go as below as 20% of its capacity, and full capacity is also there. So if you install occupancy control for this type of AC, using this type of AC, so it ideally what it should be doing, the compressor should go to its minimum capacity, which is 20 or 25%, and then you can reduce the loss of energy. For an example, if there is a hotel room, there is no one into the room and the AC is running on its full capacity, so that's a loss of energy. So that's why this occupancy control plays a vital role there to save the energy. Each conference room, meeting room in the hotels and office, they should have this kind of provision. And each classroom, staff room for educational building having AC connected. So this last point was very well connected to our visit which we conducted in Male, and one of the educational building, they were having this air conditioning installed, and what we saw that there was no occupancy and the systems, the air conditioning was running on its full load. So that's why this is more recommended for all types of these three types of buildings, four types of buildings. So this is recommended for mentioned buildings having central air conditioning or non-central air conditioning systems which are installed for thermal comfort applications. Then we have dampers. So in the central air conditioning systems, we use the dampers, and dampers are used to regulate the flow of air, whether it's fresh air which we are intaking from outside, or whether it's a cool air which is served by air condition air handling unit to the spaces. So what it says, all air supply and exhaust equipment shall have dampers that automatically closes upon when spaces are not in use and when supply fans shutdowns. So this is exempted for exhaust system of kitchen ventilation and spaces being served by natural ventilation. So in case of kitchen ventilation, the damper should not be automatically shutting down. And in case the space is served by natural ventilation, so if there is any damper which is carrying fresh air into the space, the duct is carrying fresh air into the space and you are having a damper, then it should not be automatically shutting down. Then we have auxiliary systems in place. So all the motors which we are using, so this is recommended that in case of central air conditioning system which is chiller based, all motors of air handling units on supply fans, return fans and exhaust fans shall comply with the motor efficiency IE2 as per Indian standard 12615, and it is preferable to have variable frequency drive on the motors. So this is, the technology is readily available and being used into these equipments of air handling units. So that's why this is here, that the motors also plays vital role in consuming energy. So that's why we have to optimize that energy also. Second one is pump efficiency. So in case of central air conditioning system, all primary and secondary pumps shall have minimum efficiency of 70%, and the application of VFD is preferable on the secondary pumps. The third one is important, the energy recovery. So all hotels, malls, offices which are served by central air conditioning system shall have provision of air to air recovery of heat. And just to give you a brief, what is this air to air recovery of heat? So for an example, we take an example of office. There is a conference room which is served by a central air conditioning system, and you have set the temperature as 24 degree as the set point. So the temperature of 24 degree is the set point which is sensed at the return air. It's not the supply air which you are getting a 24 degree, it is sensed at the return air. So when you set up a 24 degree in your thermostat, it means that you are getting air at around 20 degree, then it collects heat from the atmosphere, from the occupants, from the latent and sensible heat components. It gains the heat, then it goes to the return air. So at the return, if the temperature is 24, then your means whatever you are setting, it's that temperature. So in the return, when it's 24 degree, and then again you are supplying means fresh air from the outside of the building. So what happens, the fresh air outside of the buildings, suppose it's having a temperature of around 30 32 34, and what we mean by energy recovery, that the return air which is going from your occupant space is of 24 degree and you are taking fresh air from outside which is of 34 degree. So there should be a air to air recovery of the heat. So what we recommend here, that your return air and your fresh air should be in contact, so that your return air temperature, your fresh air temperature is gets down when it comes into the contact of return air. And for an example, it goes down as below as 28 or 27 degree, somewhere near to that. So then your compressor need not to work more to achieve that 24 degree of thermal comfort situation. So then it has to compress that air of fresh air of having a temperature 27 degree to 20 degree. Otherwise what it should be doing, it's taking outside air of 34 degree and taking it to 20 degrees. Then your compressor need to work more, and then the efficiency of the system is lost. So that's why we have recommended to have energy recovery in place for the buildings. So in the hospitals, the heat recovery can be done for space serving common rooms like reception, corridors and washrooms. Energy recovery is not preferable for patient rooms, operation rooms and any room which can be contaminated in the nature, in case we are talking about the hospitals. So it is to be taken care in case of hospital, that only the common areas like receptions, corridors and the washroom, they can have Otherwise, it's not preferable in particular case of hospitals. Then we have service water heating. So it is recommended that all the hotels and hospitals having built-up area greater than 2,000 square meter shall have solar water heating system for at least 20 degree of hot water requirement, and rest all demand can be met with the conventional system, which is electrical heating. And the equipment efficiency of solar water heating and electrical or gas shall meet the country standards, which are already there. So we only say about that you should have solar water heating in place, whatever your local regulations say about the efficiency, you have to follow them. But we recommend that your system size should be 20% of the total hot water requirements of the building. Then we have very important parameter of BEMS, Building Energy Management System. So BEMS for buildings employing air conditioning systems greater than 300 tons. It can be applied for residential as well as commercial buildings. It has huge potential of energy savings for big buildings like hotels, hospitals, malls, schools, colleges, and office buildings. And the recommended features for a typical BEMS systems are HVAC and lighting control, data monitoring, fire safety and security, building utilities control, and its data monitoring. So when we visited one building there in Male, and it was having a very good BMS system in place, and that was showing what systems are running, on what capacity they are running, what zones they are serving, what are the supply temperatures, what are the return temperatures. It was showing what are the dampers they are in place, how much is the opening, what are the fresh air intakes, how much is the quantity of the fresh air, what is the temperature of fresh air. So all those parameters, they were there into this building energy management system. And it plays a vital role in the big buildings, because in the big buildings, you cannot easily locate where are the leakages, what system is not working, which damper is closed, which damper is malfunctioning. So all those things you can easily locate, and by monitoring your BMS, and then you can easily rectify those things, and your efficiency is also not lost, your occupants are also in the comfort zone, and you do not panic in case your system is not working. Then we have not in kind or innovative space cooling solutions. So as of now, we have kept these three options. Either it is this is very wide open. One can select any kind of not in kind system for its thermal comfort systems. So we can say there is one upcoming technology, solar air conditioning system. So the compressor is run by the solar by the electricity generated by the solar PV, and one can install this system, and this is innovative space cooling solution, and which consumes less energy as compared to the conventional unitary air conditioning system, which is using electricity from the grid for operation. The second one is for the district cooling system. So for the big spaces, big developments, rather large developments having a mixed use kind of buildings. Mixed use kind of buildings can have daytime and nighttime running buildings. For an example, I'm having a hotel there which is 24-hour operational. I'm having a school there which is 8-hour operational. I'm having an office there which is 12-hour or 14-hour operational. So all those mixed use kind of buildings, if they are in a close proximity, and you are having residences also which are more or less operational in the night time, and the cooling load is witnessed into the night time rather as compared to the daytime. So if there is this kind of development coming up, so one can think of a district cooling system in place, and this gives you a vast range of benefits in terms of energy, in terms of capital cost, in terms of space saving, in terms of operational and maintenance cost of a system. So if you compare these things, if you compare, for an example, if there is a hotel, then a residence, then an office, then a school, And if you install one-to-one system to each buildings, then you are investing a huge lot of a chiller or whatever technology you are opting. And if you compare it with the district cooling system, you are using one system in place which is serving all those areas. Only one system is to be maintained. You have saved four building space cost as well. Either I think it's a vertical development there, so you have reduced your space going into this auxiliary kind of equipments. So there are multiple benefits of a district cooling system. And for the large developments, if I give you a range of a thumb rule, if there is a 8,000 to 10,000 tons per square kilometer of development, then this system is most viable system for air conditioning system for meeting thermal comfort applications for the occupants. So this can also be thought of if there is a large development coming up in the country. Then the radiant cooling system. So this is also picking up, and this also offers a good range of efficiency levels, and you can save around 30 to 50% energy as compared to conventional air conditioning systems if you compare apple to apple. So this gives you a very good efficiency saving, energy saving potential also in the buildings. So what we have recommended into the guidelines, that the building opting for above listed not in kind cooling solutions for more than 50% of air conditioning shall met energy efficiency level 2 as mentioned in the mandatory requirement of HVAC systems. So what I mean, if your building is having 50% area which is served by these not in kind technologies, so you should meet your equipments which you are using for either for solar air conditioning. So for solar air conditioning, you refer to unitary air conditioning, and you should meet your energy efficiency level 2 efficiency levels. For district cooling, if it is a water cooled system, so then you go to water cooled system, and your energy efficiency level 2 requirements shall be met for the district cooling system. And if your space is 90% or greater, which is served by not in kind technologies, then you should go for the energy efficiency level 3, which are there into the HVAC requirements under the mandatory section. So these are all recommendations which are there into the guidelines. Then we have important parameter which is more related to the design of the buildings. So this is about the infiltration and the air leakages. So what happens when we design the buildings and we leave unintentionally, we leave that there are some cracks, there are some openings, and which gives you, which ultimately leads to the loss of energy which is there, which we invest into the cooling of the spaces. So what happens if there is an office and you are having your air conditioning system in place, and you are having also cracks in your walls, for an example, and if you are having infiltration there below the door, or at the window also you have left some opening, so that cool air gets into the atmosphere and you do not get that effect. Although it's very marginal, but it's important in the longer run. So if you compare for the lifetime of the building, it's huge, but if you compare for a single day or for a single hour, it's not that impactful, but in the longer run it's giving you the impact on your energy saving potential. So what we have recommended, that the following areas of the building envelope of all except naturally ventilated buildings or space shall be properly sealed, caulked, gasketed, or weather stripped. So all those areas which are joints around fenestration, skylights or door frames, opening between walls and foundations, and between walls and roof and wall panels, opening at penetrations of utility services through roof, walls and floors, side build fenestration and doors, building assemblies used as ducts or plenums, all other openings in the building envelope, exhaust fan shall be fitted with the sealing device such as self-closing damper. So what happens generally in the exhaust, there is a no damper. So whatever you are having, this cool air is exhausted through the exhaust fan, which is unintentional, but nobody noticed that. So there should be a damper at the opening of the exhaust fan, which is opening into the atmosphere or the outside of the building. Operable fenestration should be constructed to eliminate leakage from fenestration frame and shutter frame. It is also recommended to use the existing infrastructure efficiently by closing window doors of the air conditioning space so as to avoid heat transfer between cold air and the ambient air. So how do we check that whether your building is having air leakage or not? So there are two parameters which indicates whether your building is having air leakage or not. So air leakage index and air permeability. So both these parameters, they represent air leakage rate per hour per square meter of the envelope area. So whatever your envelope area is, these two parameters, this gives you the indicator that what is your air leakage rate per hour per square meter of your envelope area. So what happens when we perform this air leakage test? So what is the difference between these two, air leakage and air permeability? So air leakage index, it considers only interior walls and ceiling areas, whereas the air permeability, it includes floor area in addition to the walls and ceilings. So in the permeability, what we have assumed that there is a air leakage through the floor also, rather than only from walls and the ceilings. So this test is carried out by mounting a fence or a fan within the building envelope to either pressurize or depressurize the building. And internal or external pressure difference is created, so it would be either a positive pressure or the negative pressure into the building, and based on that pressure, so the difference is acceptable with the guideline that the maximum difference can be in a range of 50 to 60 Pascal. If it is more than that, then certainly your building is having some air leakages there in your building. The test procedures to measure both the air leakage parameters in the building is outlined in CIBSE technical memoranda, so which is TM23, and the values of air tightness testing, so this can be referred with the air tightness testing and measurement association standards TSL 1 and 2 for optimal air permeability values for residential and non-residential buildings both. So for residential building, what should be the air permeability? So that can be referred in TS1, and for non-residential buildings, it can be public or commercial buildings, so that can be referred into TSL2. So this is how this test is conducted. This is recommended into the guidelines if anybody wants to perform this kind of test. So the provisions and the values are there into the guidelines. This is for the air leakage and infiltration into the buildings. These are some initiatives of ME. Sinta, would you like to talk about these?
No, please continue, Kash.
Okay. So The first one is energy efficiency label for air conditioning systems. So what we referred into are minimum requirements of the guidelines. So these are in line with this labeling requirements of the air conditioning system. So what ME has done, they have kind of standardized all the air conditioning, unitary air conditioning systems, which are going to be used in your in the country. So the scope is single phase, single split and unitary type air conditioning of both fixed and variable type of compressors of rated capacity up to 30,000 BTU per hour. So they have this initiative, which is standardizing all the unitary air conditioning up to the range of 30,000 BTU. And what we have recommended in our guidelines, so for an example, in the mandatory section which we have kept as energy efficiency level 1, which is corresponding to 3-star rating of the air conditioning systems under this program. So other initiative is financing program for EE appliances. So the concessional loans for star rated appliances will be provided to consumers by selected banks. So that framework is also under progress, and I think ME can more talk about this. And the other one is incorporating life cycle costing assessment in public procurement. So public procurement regulation to mandate all the public office to undertake LCCA to identify least cost while procuring energy consumption appliances. So LCCA favors star rated appliances due to lower energy cost over its operational period. So we can break for the questions and we can take up them.
Yeah, thank you, Akash. So I'll just read out. We've received a few questions. So the first question is by Mr. Ibrahim Fayaz, and his question is that which is more energy efficient, non-centralized air conditioners or centralized air conditioning systems? For centralized ones, which one is the best, VRF, air cooled or water cooled?
So see, the question is quite straightforward, but I would like to give more insights about this on the selection of the system. So just to answer your question, water cooled systems are the most efficient one systems in practice. But water cooled system, if you are putting that into the residential building where the consumption is not much, it's not going to give you the efficiency. So the selection of the system is very important based on your uses. So for a building which is going to be operated 24 hours or more than 12 or 14 hours in a day, water cooled systems are the best for them, best suited for them. For the residential application where you are going to have your AC running 4 to 8 hours in a day, then the water cooled systems are not going to give you the efficiency. Although they are efficient, but they are not going to give you efficiency in that particular thing. Then the non-centralized air conditioning systems with the this inverter compression technology, they are going to give you the efficiency levels there. And the VRF, they are picking up, they are efficient, they are air cooled systems, and they are more feasible when you have the system size somewhere in between to 30 tons to 100 tons or 80 tons. So they give you the best efficiency there with this kind of system size, because the loads and the building design and the operating conditions, they are very much suited for these kind of loads when you select VRF for your building.
Thank you, Akash. We have another question from Mr. Ibrahim, and the question is it possible to calculate CSPF values for centralized air conditioning systems? Currently, EER values are given, but non-centralized units are using CSPF values for defining energy efficiency level.
Yes, it is possible. We can calculate that thing, but why non-centralized systems are having CSPF? Because the manufacturers, the technology providers, they are having this uniform term of rating efficiency with CSPF. But for the chiller systems, the manufacturers or the technology providers, they have this uniform air indicator of COP and EARs, which is approved by AHRI. And AHRI is the Global Institute, Air Conditioning, Heating and Refrigeration Institute, which are worldwide involved into the standardization of these equipments which are related to AC, heating and refrigeration. So these COP and EER, they are uniformly accepted by all those things, all those manufacturers and the technology providers, because the regulating body for rating them, they are using this terminology.
Thank you, Akash. The next is, again, it's a more of a comment by Abdullah Hussein Rashid, and he wants to clarify that you mentioned that that it is not recommended to have cooling energy recovery in certain places like OT and ICU of hospitals. I think you are referring to systems that mix fresh air and recovery air, because there are also systems that achieve heat exchange without mixing incoming and outgoing air, only through contact with an exchange surface. Those systems will not compromise any sterility requirements of such rooms.
Yes, I agree. I agree. There are no contact systems are also there in place. But what I meant from air to air recovery, that was with the contact of air to air. So that was not, I was not talking about non-contact technologies. That was air to air contact. So that was more related with the mixing fresh air with the return air for the buildings. So that's why I said it's not preferable to mix air to air or use air to air contact technologies for the OT rooms or the ICUs in case of hospitals. But I agree, these kind of technologies are also available in the market.
Thank you. So thank you everyone for being so attentive and attending the session. So we've come to end of the morning session, and we will now break for lunch. And we will resume again at 1 p.m. So the other technical sections of the prescriptive requirements will be covered post lunch now. And if still anyone has any questions, please feel free to type it in the chat box and we can take up at the end of the afternoon session. So I look forward to having you all back at 1 p.m. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. You can connect back on this link to start with the training.
So welcome everybody. We can start now with the next session. I'll just start projecting. Right. So the next session is on the lighting systems. Sunita, I'm audible, right?
Yes, Akash.
Okay. So this session is on lighting system, and in particular artificial lighting system and its control. So daylighting, which we have already covered in building envelope section, what should be the daylighting, how do we calculate it, and all those things. And this session covers artificial lighting and the controls for the optimization of operation of artificial lighting. So the key aspects which we have covered into this section is for the interior lighting, the exterior lighting, which are facade lighting, and then the lighting controls. So why lighting is also important? So after air conditioning, lighting is the thing which consumes most of the energy in the buildings, and in particular the this artificial lighting that consumes more right after the air conditioning, which is being used into the buildings. So that's why lighting needs to be covered for having integrated energy efficiency with the different systems which are guzzling energy into the buildings. So that's why lighting is also covered as a component into the guidelines. So the guideline covers the mandatory section. What should be the LPD? LPD is lighting power density. So we'll see in the next slides how this is calculated. And the guideline covers the LPD values for the different application category in the different typologies of the building. So for an example, we are having a hotel, and in a hotel we are having a guest room. So the guideline says that it's mandatory to meet energy efficiency level 1 LPD, which is lighting power density in watt per meter square, and it should be within the range of 9. So for a hotel, if you are having a guest room, your LPD should meet this energy efficiency level 1, that is 9 watt per meter square. Equal to or below than this will be acceptable in case of this typologies. So for the different typologies like building, business, open plan office if it is there, so then your LPD should be in the range of 10 watt per meter square. Enclosed office, again 10 watt per meter square. Sales area, it may have some fancy lighting, so that's why the LPD is increased here, 14 watt per meter square. So for hospital, educational buildings, all those buildings, for the different commonly used or regularly occupied spaces, this artificial lighting covers the guideline covers the artificial lighting guidelines for the energy efficiency level 1. For the residential building also it covers family dining room, assembly room, food preparation, reading room, and common areas of any typology, whether it be a restroom or the corridor or the parking area, lobbies, conference meeting, staircase. So the guideline covers the entire spectrum of the different zones or the areas which are commonly witnessed into the different kind of buildings which are covered into this scope. So the LPD shall include all power used by luminaire, including lamp, ballast, regulators, and the control devices. So it's not only for the lamp, it's an entire luminaire, entire assembly of the lighting which is there. So the power should means when you are calculating LPD, so the power should be calculated including all the components which are using the power, not only the light which is using the power. Luminaire efficacy shall be 0.7 or above, and luminaire efficacy is the light output of an entire luminaire divided by the total power consumed by the lamp and ballast. It is expressed in lumens per watt. So what happens generally if we want to control our consumption in lighting, generally we use dim lights there. So the guidelines also says that whatever LPD you are meeting, whatever lighting you are installing, it should also meet the luminaire efficacy, which is 0.7 or above. So what is luminaire efficacy? It's a light output of the entire luminaire divided by the power consumed by the lamps and the ballast. So in case you compromise with your luminaire efficacy, that is not acceptable, that is not recommended. And also it is recommended to maintain the lighting levels on the different zones. So for an example, if the lux level required for a workstation which is at the height of 2.5 feet, so that should have the lux level, if it is 300 lux to be maintained, so that the artificial lighting which you are installing, that should meet those lux levels also on the different zones which are there. So it should not be compromising with the lux level in order to achieve the efficiency levels. So means energy efficiency. So basically the idea is not to compromise on the comfort conditions, then meeting our efficiency levels. So that's why it is recommended to have the luminaire efficacy first, then the LPD should be in the place within this required which are there into the guidelines. These are the recommendations. So again, if you are meeting efficiency level 1 and if you want to go beyond that, so the guideline gives you the recommendation what could be the efficiency level 2 and what could be the efficiency level 3 for the different typologies of the building and into the different areas as well. So it covers entire building typologies and all the areas which are generally having artificial lighting installed into the buildings. Then we come to the exterior lighting. So the connected lighting power of exterior lighting applications shall not exceed the power limits as below. So all the application category like building entrance, building exit, building facade, emergency signs, walkways, pathways, landscaping, so all those kind of exterior lightings are covered into the guidelines, and these efficiency levels are mandatory for these categories. So guidelines have these mandatory requirements to be followed for the exterior lighting for the different application category. So for an example, if you are having a building facade lighting, which is most common lighting which we see nowadays, so it should be 5 watt per meter square of vertical facade area. So whatever your vertical facade area is in a meter square, the limit is 5 watt per meter square of the facade lighting of the vertical facade which you want to highlight in the buildings. So these are the mandatory things mentioned into the guidelines. So this is how we calculate LPD. So for an example, if there is a room of dimension 4 by 3.6 meters, so the total floor space is around 14.4 meter square. And if you consider that the room is having 6 number of 24 watt LED bulbs, then the total lighting power is 6 multiplied by 24, which is 144. Then your lighting power density would be 144 divided by 14.4, so which is 10 watt per meter square. So this is how we typically calculate LPD of the room. So the area divided by the installed lighting power divided by the area, that is the LPD of the room. Then we have the lighting controls. So various kinds of lighting controls are available into the market, and the guideline keeps this open and gives you the recommendations what kind of controls you can install while installing your artificial lighting into the buildings. So use of various lighting controls, like all lighting systems must have switching or control capabilities, which is quite obvious, but the control capabilities should be there, on off, or if you have a dimming sensors in place, so those kind of controls should be there manually, and the automatic controls can be there. Installing occupancy sensors in conference room, washrooms and corridors. Installing daylight sensors. So daylight sensors works in integration of the daylight which is coming from during the daytime into the space, and in the evening time when the daylight gets starting reducing, so that time these sensors come into picture and they start increasing dependency on the internal artificial light. So as the daylight goes low, they increase the illuminance level from the artificial lighting. So these kind of controls can also be there, and the control of exterior lighting. The control of exterior lighting in integration with the solar photovoltaic, that is also possible. So that also comes with the dimming sensor and a daylight sensor control. So that can also be integrated. So these kind of controls can be installed for artificial lighting, which we are installing in our buildings. So any questions on the lighting we can take up now. Sanyukta, any question there?
No, Akash.
Okay, no problem. So we'll go to the next section, which is plumbing. Okay. So plumbing again. So this is more related to the water efficiency, which we want to achieve in our buildings. So water is one aspect which is neglected when we talk about energy efficiency, but in the holistic approach and the sustainability approach, water also plays an important role, and for the country, specifically for Maldives, so it is also important to cover water efficiency in our guidelines, because fresh water sources is scarce, and there is no river streams, and the groundwater are also depleted with the salt water intrusion. So that's why we have also included water efficiency in the guidelines. So what we have covered here, the plumbing fixtures and rooftop rainwater harvesting systems. So the mandatory section of this water efficiency, so it talks about plumbing fixtures for all the building typologies. Water efficient plumbing fixtures shall be installed with following flow rate values. So all the water closets, they should have maximum flow rate with 6 liters full flush capacity, and the estimated daily person use is 1 use per person, and there are certain assumptions also. So I think Sanyukta, you can have some discussion on this. You want to have?
Sure, Akash. So basically, this is a section on water efficiency, and when we conducted survey of buildings in Maldives, it was revealed that none of the buildings used low flow fixtures, and we found that there were very few buildings where new buildings did have dual flush fixtures and flow sensors, but in terms of low flow water fixtures, that was something that was not provided. So in order to, like Akash mentioned, to provide water, at least a basic level of water efficiency in our buildings, the guidelines have been developed. And it basically caters to two aspects, which are low flow and flush fixtures, and it proposes rainwater harvesting systems. So this first requirement is of the plumbing fixtures, wherein the maximum flow rates have been specified in the guidelines. So in terms of water closets, the guidelines recommend dual flush fixtures with the full flush of 6 liters per flush and half flush as 3 liters per flush. Urinals, the flow recommended is 4 liters per flush. Then in terms of faucets and taps, the flow rate recommended is 6 liters per minute. It estimatedly durated about four use per day. And in terms of shower head and rain showers or handheld sprays, the maximum flow rate is 10 liters per minute. So these flush and flow rates have been designed for a pressure bar of 3. So if the pressure bar varies, then the flush and flow rates will change. But this is assumed for a pressure bar of 3. And it estimates that occupants spends around 8 hours per day in a government or a commercial building. And faucets, taps, which are used for dishwashing and washing clothes, are not considered in this. And it even the plumbing fixtures, which are to do with irrigation systems, are not considered in the guidelines. So these are only meant for the specified fixture types, which are mentioned on the slide. So can we move to the next slide, please? Then the next recommendation in the guideline is to install rainwater harvesting system, rooftop rainwater harvesting system. So for all building typologies, it is recommended that rooftop rainwater harvesting systems shall be provided to capture at least 25% of the runoff volume from the roof area, and it would be collected and reused to reduce dependence on piped water supply. So the rainwater harvesting calculations have been done looking at the rainfall data. So the average rainfall data for wet season, which is around 9.5 mm per day, can be used for calculating. And the number of days, average rainfall days, have been considered 15 days per month. So it was also observed during the climate analysis that rainfall in Maldives has drastically increased in the last couple of years, which is why this is recommended in the guidelines. And so the calculation is very simple. So if you look at the red box, in order to calculate the runoff volume, we need to multiply the surface area of our roof, whatever area that we have of the roof, runoff coefficient, and multiplied by the average rainfall. So the rainfall values are already given. We can take 9.5 mm per day. Runoff coefficient is basically, it varies with the kind of surface material we have on the roof. So if we have cement tiles, then runoff coefficient is around 0.62 to 0.69. If it's a metal sheet, then around 80 to 85% runoff coefficient can be considered. So these have been taken up from the guidelines and manual for rainwater harvesting. This is a document which is published by the government of Republic of Maldives in 2009. So detailed calculations on how to design the rainwater harvesting systems, we can look up this manual and guidelines. So this is the recommendation in the guidelines for rooftop harvesting system. And this system can be used, the water which is collected can be used for landscaping, for irrigation, it can also be used for flushing purposes. It can also be used for cooling tower makeup water requirement in case we have water cooled chillers in the building. So there are various ways, indoor uses and outdoor uses where this rainwater can be collected and reused in order to reduce the demand of piped water supply. So this is pretty much the plumbing system. Over to you, Akash.
Right. So the next section is about the renewable energy systems. What we see there when we visited the existing buildings and we surveyed them, so we saw that the potential of solar PV is huge, and the buildings are already using this technology, and they are harvesting energy from solar energy and using their internal systems. This electricity generated, which is generated by solar PV, is being used into the operations and the runnings of the existing electrical systems of the building, such as lighting and others. So that's why these renewable energy systems are also integrated into our guidelines, and it does not limit to solar. So it also covers the various systems, so that has kept open whatever the local regulation is, that should also be kept in mind, and that is also integrated into the guideline. So it was observed that the solar radiation in Maldives showed that the roof of the buildings in Maldives receives higher solar radiation during most part of the year, and that gives the good viability and the feasibility of having solar rooftop system installed there into the buildings. So thus, use of renewable energy system that harness solar energy in buildings can offset the electricity consumption from the grid, and that uses the fossil fuel. So that's how we can reduce the dependency on the grid. What guidelines is? So the guidelines have the recommendations having the solar renewable energy system in the buildings. So in all building typologies, renewable energy system should constitute 2.5% of the total electricity consumption of the building. So whatever your total electricity consumption of the building is, your renewable system, renewable energy based system, should be 2.5% of the total energy consumption of the building. So for an example, if your annual consumption of a building is 1000 units, so your renewable energy system can be 2.5% of it. So you can install 2.5% of 1000, and which is 25 kilowatt hour based renewable energy system. So it could be renewable energy system, could be solar photovoltaic. If there is a feasibility of having a wind based renewable energy system, we are open to that. If there is a feasibility of having waste to energy kind of thing, we are open to that. So that the guidelines does not restrict you having a solar based renewable energy system, but what we witnessed there, that most of the buildings are having solar photovoltaic, and the technology is also coming up. The technology is also trusted and widely used. So that's why the focus is on solar based renewable energy system. But if anybody wants to have any feasibility of other renewable energy systems, they are open to it and they can opt for it. So the maximum capacity of the electricity generated by renewable energy being connected to the grid should be determined in such a way that the electricity generated per month is not greater than the monthly electricity requirement of the building. So just to keep in mind that this is minimum 2.5%. If you want to go for the higher limit, so you need to keep that in mind, that your monthly generation of electricity should not be greater than the consumption of your building. So you should not be generating more than you are consuming. So this is in line with the local regulations there, which are there in Maldives, and this is how it is synchronized with the existing regulations. So guidelines also syncing with the existing regulation. This is not contradicting them. So the user can opt what can be the size of the renewable energy system based on the guidelines, and what should not be doing, what could be the regulations for installing, regards to structure, regards to permissions, regards to technology. So those can be referred to the local regulations. Also, the load bearing structure in case of solar PV should be in line with the local structural requirements to ensure capability of building to withstand the installed RE system. So since there is a vertical development going on, and when we are installing solar PV, so it comes with the structure also. So one needs to take care of the structural requirement, and whatever solar you are installing on your roof, so that load bearing structure which is when you install solar PV should be in line with the local structural requirement, and the idea is that your building should withstand that load also. and you are installing that solar PV for the lifespan of around 20 years, so your building should also withstand that load. And this should be referred to the local structural requirement of the Maldives. So the next section, it covers the building operation. So this is why this is important, because every time we see, and from the experience of the different countries, the people and the ministries and the governments, they have the guidelines in place, but and the end user also have accepted and adopted these guidelines. They are designing and constructing their buildings with these guidelines, but what happens when they monitor the energy performance of the building, that is not which they designed for. So ideally, what's happening, you design the building meeting all the mandatory requirements, and we estimated that this is the indicator, that EPI should be this number, energy performance index should be this number. But when you operate your building, your building is not operating as you designed. So that's why this building operation part is also significant, to meet with the design requirements and to ensure that your building is operating for what you designed it. So a significant part of building energy consumption is attributed to air conditioning and electrical systems, and installing energy efficient systems alone cannot reduce energy consumption unless they are operated at optimum levels, as well as regularly maintained to realize desired performance levels. So if they are not operated and maintained well, their efficiency will not be achieved, and ultimately the building owner, they gets the penalty in terms of energy loss, because they installed a highly efficient system, but it's not operated and maintained well, and it's not giving the efficiency, and they invested in the capital investment for having efficient system, that's is not achieved. So that's why this building operation is very important for the buildings. So what guidelines says, there are some mandatory things. So ensure building operation, or ensure operating temperature of air conditioning systems within the range of 25 degree plus minus 1 degree. So based on the climatic conditions, based on the set points which are already there into the ongoing buildings, ongoing systems which are used into the buildings. So this number comes from there, that most of the buildings are already operating within this range of thermal comfort. So if you are maintaining your set points as 24, 25 or 26, you will achieve your thermal comfort. If you are going below 22, 23, 21, you are going to have thermal comfort, but again that can also be achieved at the temperature of 24 degrees centigrade. But if you maintain your 24 degrees centigrade, you will achieve energy efficiency as well within your system. So that's the mandatory thing into the building, which says that ensure operating temperature of air conditioning system within the range of 25 plus minus 1 degree. Then the second is, perform periodical checks of equipment performance. So once in a year for chiller, cooling towers, AHUs, pumps and motors, and bi-yearly for unitary air conditioning products, which are split ACs and window ACs and cassette ACs. So due to the ambient conditions, we saw that the condensing units are having some films there, and that's why this bi-yearly check for unitary air conditioning is there, and the yearly check for all other central air conditioning equipments which is there into the guidelines. So this is the mandatory thing. And third is, create awareness like signages, training modules for the occupants to operate buildings on the set points which are prescribed into the guidelines, or onto the operational things like switch off the AC when you are not using it, switch off the lights when you are not into the room, use water efficiently. All those kind of trainings and awareness kind of things can be done for the occupants of the building. recommendations are, so these are the recommendations. First one is develop general building operation and maintenance plan for electrical and mechanical equipments. So all the electrical and mechanical equipments, they should have their O&M plan in place. So this is the responsibility from O&M team, operation and management team of the buildings which operates air conditioning and electrical system. So these kind of guidelines or the plans, they will include the technical specifications of the equipments and what should be the periodic checks related to the periodic checks. So they can keep the record that when was the filter changed lastly, and when is the next due date to change the filter. So these kind of things can be included into the plan by the O&M team. Perform time to time cleaning and changing of filters, specifically for air conditioning systems. So what we saw there, the filters were choked for the unitary air conditioning systems, and that's why the people was keeping the set point low, because it was not giving you the that desired temperature, because the filters were choked. So it is recommended to perform time to time cleaning and changing of filters, specifically for the air conditioning systems. Strategical placement of outdoor units of unitary air conditioning, so that the heat rejected from the outdoor units do not enter the adjacent building. So this is important because the closely densed buildings, what happens there? So for the unitary air conditioning systems, the outdoor units are placed such as that their exhaust is going in as a inlet to the next building. So it should not be the case, because you are rejecting your heat from your building, but you are throwing it into the other building. So that strategical placement of the outdoor units should be there. So it depends case to case what should be the placement, where should you place your outdoor units, but the guideline recommends that it should be strategical. Mandating detailed energy assessment or post-occupancy evaluation of buildings in every 3 years. So energy audit is should be there for the big buildings, and these energy auditing of the buildings will gives the results related to the operations of the building, related to the life of the equipment. So if the guideline recommends that that energy auditing should be done in every 3 years and of the buildings, and this will gives, if your O&M plans are already in place, then your energy audit will confirm that your O&M team is working fine and your equipments are working fine, the desired efficiency levels are achieved. But to ensure this, we need to have this energy assessment in every 3 years of the building. We can have the questions related to it.
Thanks, Akash. So we have received two questions. One was that are there any recommendations for grey water reuse system in the guidelines? So currently there are no recommendations for grey water reuse. The guidelines are the first step towards water efficiency. So we have only recommended low flow and flush plumbing fixtures and rainwater harvesting systems, and currently grey water reuse systems have not been added in the guidelines. Then the next question is from Mr. Afra Ismail. It's a comment. He says that waste to energy is not renewable energy. Referring to waste to energy as that is wrong and should be removed as something that this guideline promotes. It conflicts with our net zero aspirations, as waste to energy generates carbon at a similar scale as coal power generation. Akash?
Well, it's an interesting topic for a debate, but your point is well noted that waste to energy is not a renewable energy and it generates carbon. But on the other hand, when we talk about generation of solar panels, so that also again generates carbon. So that it's altogether a topic of discussion. Well, but the guidelines does not specifically says that waste to energy is renewable. That's just an example. It does not specifies any technologies or any other thing. which can be contradictory to net zero aspirations. It does not cover that.
Thank you, Akash. So I think with this, we are done with the, there is one more question. Is there any reason why 2.5% is selected as amount of power generated by renewable energy power systems?
Right. So why it is considered, it's on the basis of the availability of the roof space for installing solar PVs. So in a typical building, we calculated what could be the 2.5% of the annual energy consumption and what should be the space requirement for installing that. So that is back calculated, and that's why it's capped as low as 2.5%. If the space is available, you can go higher, but it's a general calculation that for any building, any good size of building, which is having a connected load or energy consumption of around 1000, so that space is already there into the buildings for installation of this solar PV on the roof.
Akash, there's one more question regarding the Lumina efficacy.
Yeah.
Any reason why 0.7 is selected? And also a comment that even the lowest efficacy LED lights I have seen encountered have values greater than 70 to 80 lumen per watt. I understand you need to consider other types of lights like incandescent, fluorescent, gas discharge, etc. But 0.7 lumen per watt is an extremely low bar to set, in my opinion. By Abdullah Hussain Rashid.
Yeah, I noted that point, and as he himself said that encountered have greater values than 70 to 80. So let's again recheck this figure, and if the technology permits us to raise this, and based on the conditions and based on the future demands of LED technology, we can certainly raise this thing and we can revise this number. We'll check this.
Okay, so the next question is from Ibrahim Shias. Says Malé and Podomalé space development space for development is heavily congested. Do you have any specific options to such congested spaces to comply with the energy efficiency guidelines?
So that's more of a planning issue, and that's again, yes, that's rightly pointed out that it's, you know, heavily congested and the densities are very high. So in order to comply with the energy efficiency guidelines, therefore we have given that flexibility, because we understand there are a lot of constraints in terms of space availability, site related constraints. So therefore the guidelines are flexible, and they do not, most of the things are a recommendation on not mandatory requirements, keeping in mind that there is a space constraint in Malé and Holomalé. So that has been taken into account. But if there is something specific that you feel that it would be difficult to comply with and is a mandatory requirement, then please feel free to comment and reach out to us to, regarding that.
Is there any more questions, comments?
So I think in us, there are, we do not have any more questions.